Good evening. Welcome to the program. My very, very special guest tonight is a multi-Grammy Award-winning singer who set the music charts on fire in the 1970s before shooting to even greater fame as the leading lady in that wonderfully successful film called Grease, Olivia Newton-John. She made the United States her home about 30 years ago, but fortunately for us, she continues to come back to Australia. And I have to tell you that her Australian accent is still very, very much intact. Olivia Newton-John joins me now. Olivia, where were you born?
I was born in Cambridge, England.
How old were you when you left?
I left England when I was 5, and my father was offered a job as Master of Woman College in Melbourne.
So can you remember England?
Vaguely. I have memories of the street I lived in Cambridge, and the lane opposite that seemed really big and spooky to me, and I went back years later and it was just a tiny little lane with small trees in it.
Well, that's the way of the
world.
Yeah, things
exactly.
Look big when you're little.
Yeah.
But you're not very big now, are you? Still pretty little.
Bigger than I was. But
bigger. So you went to Melbourne because your dad had to go to Melbourne.
Yes,
he got he was a professor in German.
He was a professor of German, but he was offered the job of Master of Woman College, and he was the youngest master ever in Australia. He was 40, the Master of a College, which is, I was very proud to read that recently. I didn't even know that myself.
Tell me about your parents.
We'll start with Dad, because we were there already. My father was Welsh, and he was born in Cardiff. His father, I think, was a carpenter, and he came from a pretty humble background, but he was extremely brilliant and won a scholarship to Cambridge, where he was kind of ducks of his class and honor student and became a...
All this he's obviously passed on.
Yes, he passed on 8 years ago.
But he's also passed all this knowledge and talent on to you.
Well, he
had being a Welshman, he's probably a good singer too.
He had a wonderful singing voice, and he passed on the voice to me and the love of acting. He could have been an actor, but he chose, or a singer, but he chose to be an academic. Lucky he had the choice. I didn't have a choice. I didn't have the academic thing that I could sing.
Would you have taken the academia role if you had have had a choice?
I doubt it. I doubt it. I think that I kind of fulfilled my father's dream, because I think he really would have loved to have sung. But he didn't think he was good enough. He was a perfectionist, and he had one recording of his voice, and it had one bad note in it, so he destroyed it, so we never got to hear it.
Really?
I think he passed it on to me. I was a bit phobic like that in the beginning.
And what about your mum?
My mum is a wonderful, very bright woman who lives in Melbourne, and her father was Max Born, who won the Nobel Prize for Physics in, I think, 52 or 54, I get confused, but he was a quantum physicist and he was a good friend of Einstein. And my mother actually translated a book of letters between my grandfather, Max Born, and Einstein into English from German. So,
well, you've got to have some pretty good grey matter up there with heritage like that.
I don't know what happened to me, but anyway. I got the music part, but the other part, I don't know.
What about brothers and sisters? Any brothers and sisters?
I have a brother who lives in Melbourne. He's a doctor. My brother, the doctor, I'm very proud. And my sister lives in Los Angeles. She was an actress when she was younger. Now she's writing scripts for movies and television. And, yeah, I've got a diverse family.
Your dad, even though he was a Welshman and a singer, he'd have to be fairly conservative. And by the sound of things, your mother would be fairly conservative. What did they think when you decided to go into show business?
Interestingly enough, my mother is not conservative. My mother is very broad-minded and very young in spirit and has always been very open-minded. She wanted me to finish school because she was concerned what would happen to me, you know, if I didn't. My father, who they were not living together at the time, he was at Newcastle University by that stage, had less to say about it, but I think he would have liked me to finish school. But when they saw that I could actually earn a living singing and doing show business, they were very encouraging after that. In fact, Mum whipped me off to England when I was 16 because I'd won a trip over there on Johnny O'Keefe's Sing Sing Sing. So I went there when I was 16, going on 17, and that's where it all started.
What were you like at school?
Distracted. I think that my mind was always somewhere else. I think two reasons for that. One, my parents were going through a divorce when I was 10, which is a difficult time, and not many kids were going through it at that stage. Now it's quite common, but when I was 10, it was not common.
Well.
So I was a little distracted and didn't focus too well. I was quite bright, but I didn't study. So, Chloe, don't listen to this. I was great at school and I studied all the time.
So how did you get to your music? I mean, it's obvious you would have had an interest in it, but how did you start your music?
Well, my sister was married to a man who had a coffee lounge in Melbourne, and I went in there one weekend with her, and there was a folk singer on the stage, and he was singing, and I started singing harmonies from my seat, and he invited me up on stage, and then after that came like a weekend thing, and I formed a girl singing group with three other girls called the Soul Four, and we used to sing.
Where did that name come from?
Oh, we thought it was very European, you know, Soul for the Sun in French, and four of us, and we thought we were really chic, you know. And it was the time of the bodgies and the widgies, you know, when people wore the...
I certainly remember that.
And we were, what do you call them? I forgot the name. We were the beatnik types. I can't remember what we called them then. And we had the long hair and the Hessian jackets and the turtlenecks, and we sang kind of traditional jazz down by the riverside and all those things. And so anyway, I was allowed to sing in the coffee lounge, but my mother put an end to the girl group because she thought it was distracting from my homework, which it probably was. And
so you actually did what your mother told you?
Mostly.
Well, I mean, pretty rare. She said, stop the group, this has got to stop.
So you were
fairly well disciplined.
I guess I was. You know, there were things that she doesn't know that I did when she told me not to, but basically I did stop that. But I was allowed to sing on the weekends at this coffee place, and there was a talent quest going on Sing Sing Sing, and Johnny O'Keefe was auditioning people for that, so Ian Turpie, who was my boyfriend then, played guitar for me, and we went up to Johnny's room and I sang for him, and I got onto this heat of this contest, and much to my amazement I won this national contest, and the prize was a trip to London, which I took a year later.
If one believes what one reads, Ian Turpie was kind of the love of your life. You fell desperately in love with him at the age of 15 or something.
Well, I think your first love is a very powerful thing.
Yeah.
So it was a strong thing then. Sure. He's a very nice man. We're still friends, and I'm friends with Jan, and that's really nice.
Sure, he is a very nice man. So you got onto TV by doing this talent quest thing.
Yeah.
Is that how you got on Johnny's show?
I got on Johnny's show, and I was still at school. And also at the same time, I think the Christmas of that year, there was a show on television, I'm sure you remember, called The Happy Show with Happy Hammond.
Yeah.
He used to wear the tartan hat and the tartan jacket.
I remember.
Yeah, and they were having, over the Christmas holidays, Lovely Anne was getting married, so they asked me would I replace her for the Christmas vacation, and Panda was on, and it was an
amazing
show.
What did family say about that? Was that okay?
That was okay, because it was during the holidays. But out of that, I was offered a job at Channel 7, so I left school. That's when I left school and took a permanent job doing Time for Terry with Terry O'Neill.
Yeah.
And that's where I got all my experience. I think it was the best thing could have happened to me, because I had to do what you do, live television and tape, you know, do three live a week and tape two a week. And we did music hall, and we did, we had to learn songs and do them straight away with idiot cards. And it was an incredible lesson in television right off the bat.
When you think how early you started, you've had terrific experience, haven't you, in all facets of the industry.
I think it was really fortunate that I started in Australia, because I was able to do all those things and learn it here when television was growing and there was lots to do. I did the Go Show, which was a pop show every week, and I used to do commercials on that show. You know, I remember doing commercials for ICI, Zips, and so I did commercials, I did music hall, I introduced kids, you know, on the Happy Show. So it was an amazing experience, very early.
Then you left Australia.
Left Australia, intending to come back pretty quickly.
And didn't.
And no, Mum kind of took me and said, you know, I want you to go to England, must take advantage of this trip. And she wanted me to go to RADA, which is the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art. I wasn't really interested in it, but I kind of went along with it till we got there, and then I didn't really follow it up. I wanted to sing, but I wasn't really interested in going to a drama school.
So you left because you'd won a trip?
Yes. On the Sing 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 show, I won the trip, and it was on Sit My Line, and we got a cruise to England and a little bit of prize money, which Mum had put away for me. And I just wanted to get back. I didn't really want to stay in London, but she kept stopping me, because I used to go to this... there's a travel agent around the corner from the flat we lived in. I kept booking my ticket, and she figured it out and went in there and said, has my daughter been in here and booked a ticket? She'd cancelled. So I ended up staying a while, and then Pat Carroll, who was on Bandstand, was given a contract by Bernard Delfont in London, and so she came over. She was given the trip, I think, by 3XY over here, or I think it was 3XY. She came to London and intended to stay with me for like a night, where she found somewhere to live, and ended up living with my mum and myself, and we formed a double act because she didn't like working on her own. She did one job in a club and didn't like being on her own. So Ethel Guy from the Seekers said to us, why don't you join up as a double act? And
so was this pre-Seekers?
No, the Seekers were working at that point. Ethel was a really good friend to us then.
How did you meet Bruce Wells?
We opened for them, Pat and I. Pat and Olivia were on with the Shadows.
Yeah.
I think it was Bournemouth. Yeah.
And did you fall in love with him?
Eventually, yes. We were friends for a while, and then when I went back to England the second time.
He was guitarist for the Shadows with Hank Marvin?
He was a rhythm guitar with Hank Marvin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Terrific guitarist, Hank Marvin.
Yeah.
And
he is
Bruce.
Fantastic.
So what happened there?
With which part of this?
With Bruce, you became engaged.
Oh, with Bruce. We became engaged after a number of years, and Pat had to go back to Australia because her visa ran out, and they wouldn't let her stay. So I stayed on because of Bruce, and she came back to Australia and married John Farrar. And ironically enough, and it's really amazing how our lives have stayed together, Pat married John. John was invited to join the Shadows, and he came back to England, and then Bruce and John produced my first records, which...
Isn't that extraordinary?
It is. It's really amazing, because he played all the guitars and co-produced with Bruce, and then when Bruce and I broke up, John continued to produce and wrote many of my hit songs, and my favourite songs, I think, are John's.
Why did it end with Bruce?
Oh, gosh, it's so long ago. I don't even remember. Just didn't work. I mean, those things are so personal. I don't think they're just between he and I.
Yeah, I guess they are.
Yeah.
People are interested.
I know.
Do you find it annoying that people are interested?
I think it's human to be interested, but I think that when you're in the public eye, I don't think it's fair to the other people to talk about your private life and
maybe not the
all
other
that.
People.
No.
We'll have a little break here, and I'll come back and talk some more with Olivia Newton-John. Thank you very much for staying with us. My very special guest is Olivia Newton-John. First record was when? 73?
First record was 71.
One.
And it's amazing to me that next year is the 30th anniversary of that. Is that unbelievable? I can't even believe it. The concept of it.
When came I Honestly Love You?
Honestly Love You're talking years now. I'm so bad with years.
Well, shortly after?
It was a few years after that, in middle 70s, I believe, yeah.
And when Greece?
And Greece was 79. I think it was 79. I think we made it in 78, came out in 79.
And did you work constantly from the beginning of the 70s to the end?
Yeah, I worked pretty constantly in those days. I travelled a lot and travelled the world and went to America, I think, in 74. Moved to America. I was in the Eurovision Song Contest representing England, and it was the year that ABBA won. I think it was 74, I believe. And I lost, and ABBA won, and it was kind of a difficult time in my life, relationship-wise, so I took it as a wonderful excuse to move to America. And Helen Reddy actually said to me at that time, if you want to make it in America, you really need to be here. You need to move and be available so that you can take advantage of the opportunity. So I did. I can't believe I did all these things, but I moved to Los Angeles in 74.
And then did Greece in 79. What did you do between 74 and 79? Work in L.A.?
Yeah, I traveled America a lot. I remember my first tour was on a Greyhound bus around the Midwest, Minneapolis, and that area. And the promoter had arranged a band for me. So I flew into Minneapolis to work with this band. And John Farrar was my MD. And they were terrible. And we rehearsed all day, and it wasn't working. So we found a local group that lived in the area. They were called This Oneness. They were just lovely guys. They came in at the last minute, learnt the show that evening, and we had to leave the next morning to drive like 8 hours to the first show. We practiced on the bus. The drummer had like a book, and the guitarist had their guitars out, and they learnt this whole show in the bus. Somehow we fluffed our way through it, and then we did a whole tour together for a couple of months, and they were great. But this bus was so old that you'd hit the seats and dust would hit the ceiling, you know. I have great memories, though.
Boy, you have what memories?
Yeah.
You must do an autobiography.
One day I will, yeah.
Because, I mean, all the experiences you've had.
I know. I've had an amazing life, I have.
So then comes Greece. Let's have a little look at Olivia in Greece.
Grease was amazing. It was a phenomenon. It still is a phenomenon.
Still.
It's amazing to me. People still come up to me who have little kids, 7 and 8 years old, who've just discovered this movie. I don't know what they think when they look at me. That's Sandy. Anyway, John Travolta said to me at the last anniversary, we just had our 20th anniversary in
a year ago
or whatever it is, and he said, this 20th anniversary is fine, but the next one...
Forget it.
Forget it. I'm not sure about that one.
How old were you when you did it?
I was 28 or 29,
and
I was playing 17, and I was really concerned about it, actually, at the time.
You didn't have to be.
But looking back, I realized that, but at the time, you know, it's all relative. And I was really nervous about doing the movie because I had made a film a few years before in England called Tomorrow, which was a fantasy musical set in, you know, we went to outer space. It's hard to explain. You'd have to see it, but... We were a manufactured group put together by Don Kirshner and Harry Saltzman. Don Kirshner had put together the Monkees. Harry Saltzman did all the Bond movies. So they wanted to start a new group that would be in a series of films. So they put me as the kind of all-American, all-Australian girl singer. We had an all-American boy, Ben Thomas. We had an English kind of Tommy Steele character, Vic Cooper, and a gorgeous black drummer from Philadelphia, Carl Chambers. So we're in this group, and we made this movie, and it didn't do well, but we had a great experience. Again, I had an amazing experience. I went to America for the first time and worked with Phil Ramone and all these amazing producers over there. But it was such a disaster that I was really afraid of having another disaster because my musical career was just starting to work. So I asked the producer, Alan Carr, who had asked me if I'd do the movie, if I could please do a screen test with the man they had in mind for the leading man, because I wanted to see myself and make sure that I'd be okay. And we did a screen test, and we just really connected really well. So.
And then Xanadu.
And Xanadu. Which was...
It didn't work as well, did it?
Xanadu didn't work because I think... the music was wonderful. John Farrar did the music, and ELO, Electric Light Orchestra, who were very popular at the time. The music was great, the dancing was great. I got to dance with Gene Kelly, so what could be bad? I mean, I danced with John Travolta in Greece and then Gene Kelly, so that was enough. But the script wasn't working, and unfortunately, the director was going through a divorce at the time and didn't like music, so the combination of those things... The script was being rewritten daily, and it didn't work too well. I don't really like my acting scenes in it very much, but the music is great.
Let's refresh our memory of Olivia in Xanadu. Tell me about Gene Kelly.
Gene Kelly was a lovely man. Very
little?
I don't remember his being little because his presence is so big.
Yeah.
And
I think short.
Yeah, I don't think he was very tall, but he knew exactly what he wanted, and he directed the tap dancing scene. Now, can you imagine? Here I am. I've never tap danced in my life, and I have to tap dance for the first time with Gene Kelly. So I went off to tap school for like 2 or 3 months before, and then... Kenny Ortega, who was the choreographer on the rest of the movie, and I worked every day. I was so nervous the first day that he came in, and I had to actually dance with him. I was dying. But he was wonderful. He was really encouraging, and he was very, very nice, and he made it very easy for me.
And very physical, the way he danced.
Yeah, still. And he was I think he was in his 70s then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's interesting, isn't it? We all think that you have this wonderful life and go and make movies and sing and dance. Little do we know that you've got to go off to tap school and you worry about dancing with Gene Kelly. We think it's all just like that.
Yeah. Well, it is a wonderful life, though. I can't say it is anything different. Especially when I talk about it, I go, wow, you know, I really did those things. It's really quite wonderful.
We'll have a little break here and I'll come back and talk some more with Olivia Newton-John. Don't go away. I'm glad you're still there, as my very special guest is Olivia Newton-John. You went back and worked with John Travolta again.
Yes, and we made a movie called Two of a Kind that I think, in retrospect, we rushed into it. We wanted to work together again. And I think we kind of jumped in before the script was really ready, and that was a bit of a mistake too, because the script really wasn't there. And it could have been really good, but it unfortunately wasn't quite there.
What kind of man is John Travolta?
He's lovely, a lovely human being.
He's very clever, I believe.
He's very clever, he's very funny, he's very, he's got a lovely heart. He's a really very sweet man.
Now a very, very good actor, doing some terrific things.
He's fantastic, isn't he? Yeah. I knew he was. He took a little break for a while. You know, I don't think a career can just keep going like that forever. You have to have your peaks and valleys in order to grow.
I think he just quit for a while and bought Rodeo Drive. I think he bought real estate all over the place.
I think he loves his plane, and I think one of his big hobbies is to fly his planes, and I think for a few years he just was flying all over the place and having fun.
But he does some good films. He does very well. Did
he's
you see Primary Colors?
I did. I thought he was fantastic as Clinton.
I thought he was fantastic.
And when I met President Clinton, I kept thinking of John.
Yeah.
It was really funny.
Oh, he did that extremely well.
Yeah.
And the other
perfect.
One I loved in that was Kathy Bates. I thought she was just
she was wonderful.
Great actress.
Mm, she is.
And then you went off and got married.
Yes.
What'd you do that for?
Well, I fell in love and I wanted to have a child.
And you did?
And I did. Yeah, about a year after.
Chloe.
Rose.
How old is Chloe now?
She's 14. She'll be 15 at the end of the year.
Then you sort of had a downtime, I think, didn't you?
I took time off. I decided that I really wanted to have time with her and devote some time to being at home. I actually ended up making a lullaby album when she was about three. I came back to Australia and did a lullaby album with the Melbourne Philharmonic Orchestra, which was a lovely experience, hoping this would help make her sleep. She didn't sleep much.
So you make a beautiful album with a hideous ulterior motive. Put the kids to sleep.
Yeah, it didn't work either. So.
And then your father died.
Yes.
That must have been tough.
My father died. It was an incredible weekend, actually. He died the weekend. It was my brother's birthday. My father died, and I found out I had breast cancer all at the same time. It was like a triple whammy. All at the same weekend. It was like unbelievable.
That when you learn that you may have breast cancer, how did you react?
Well, I think I had a clue that I might have, because I'd had a lump and I'd gone in for a biopsy. Initially, I'd gone in for a checkup and they couldn't find anything, but I knew the needle biopsy was negative. That's when they kind of put a needle and bring fluid out.
Yeah.
That was negative, and the mammogram was negative. And I don't say this to scare people. I just say this so that women, if they have an instinct that something's wrong, pursue it further, which I did. And the surgeon, who I'd been going to quite regularly because I had lumps in the past, felt there was something wrong and kind of insisted that I had a surgical biopsy. And that's when they found it, thank goodness for me.
And removed it.
And
all gone.
All gone, but then I had to have chemotherapy after that.
Was that awful?
The fear of it was actually worse than reality. I had a really terrible fear of chemotherapy because a year before I had breast cancer, my best friends had lost their daughter to cancer. Her name was Colette, and she was Chloe's best friend. And she'd had a Wilms tumor, which is a kidney cancer, and usually curable, but she'd gone through horrendous surgery and then horrendous forms of chemo, and I think watching that made me very fearful. But by when I had my chemotherapy, it really wasn't as bad as my imagination had told me it was going to be.
When they told you that you had breast cancer, were you angry?
No, no. I never had that. I never had that why not, why me thing, because why not? You know, it's happening to one in eight women in the world, and why not me? And so, I actually wrote a song called "Don't Say Why Me, Why Not Me," because I really felt strongly that that was not. Anger is a useless thing to feel. I just felt frightened in the beginning, of course. Terrified for a few nights. I think when my legs went to jelly and I couldn't walk because I didn't know. I was having these tests the next morning and I wasn't really sure what they were going to show. Was it in my whole body? Was it just localized? That's a really horrible feeling. And I'm sure everybody that has cancer has those moments. Very overwhelming fear. And then went through those things where they put radioactive dye in your body and you go through a scanner and try to actually find the humor in it, because I think humor and laughter is one of the greatest ways to get through things. And I had great friends. My friend Nancy, who had lost her daughter and lost her brother to AIDS and had been through so much, was so wonderful to me in that period, and told me that, you know, I was going to set the stage for how everybody else was. And I started laughing a lot then. It was like the only way. It was like, what else can happen? My father's died. I have cancer. What else can happen? It was almost, I had to laugh. That was my way around it. You know, it was, I laughed a lot. People thought I was probably wacky, but it was my way around it.
Did you actually...
Can I just have a sip, excuse me?
Sure. Did you actually think you might die?
Only for a minute. I didn't really believe I would, and I think that I really believe that your thought process is a big part of your healing, and you have to believe you'll be okay. And I believed I would be all right. After that initial, when I went through the initial fear and found out that it was localized, then I was okay. I had my moments, but basically I was okay.
Did all the publicity upset you?
I don't think I had time to worry about the publicity, but the reason I actually became public about it, because I was really forced into being public about it, because one of the...
Was that frustrating?
Not frustrating. I was worried about upsetting my family, and I thought that if one of these rag papers came out with a horrible story about my fight with death or one of those headlines they come out with, that would be much worse. So I had to make a choice, and my choice was to be open about it. And that was hard for me. I'm kind of a I'm not so much now, but I was a very private person. And this is a, you know, your breasts are very personal, and,
sure.
And to talk about it was, it felt like very, very exploitive to me. But really, it was very healthy, and, you know, every woman in the world has breasts, not such a big deal. It was actually very healthy for me. I was able to talk about it. Therefore, it opened the door to talking to other people who had been through the same experience, which was very helpful. I recommend that to other women. If you can talk to someone else who's been there, very helpful. And in fact, one of my most wonderful moments was when I came back to Australia. After I'd finished all my therapies and I came back here, I was actually up in the Dandenongs having lunch with my mum, and I went into the bathroom, and this woman came in there, and she said, "Oh, love," she said, "I saw in the paper that you've just gone through breast cancer, and I just want you to know that I had it 20 years ago, and I'm fine." And do you know, that was an amazing moment, because it was just for me like 9 months. And whoever that lady is, I want to thank her, because she really affected me. And so I know that when I tell someone, you know, it's 8 years for me, maybe it gives them some hope. So that was really important.
If you had to register the worst downtime in your life, would that have been it?
There's a whole lot at once. Colette's death, which is very, very tragic for me. My father.
Yeah.
I didn't really have time to grieve my father because there was so much going on. And my divorce, I guess that was like a year later, but all those things kind of compounded one after another. They're all losses in a different way. So, all of those.
Do you get depressed?
Short periods of time, but not really. I'm not a depressed kind of person, but I have my moments, and I think you need them. You have to go there and go through the pain, and I have ways of getting myself out of it.
We'll have a little break here, and I'll come back and talk some more with Olivia Newton-John. Thank you very much for staying with us. My very special guest is Olivia Newton-John. What happened with Koala Blue? Because I used to see it when I went to Los Angeles. I used to go. Was it on Melrose?
It was on Melrose. One of them. We had a whole bunch.
Yeah, that's right.
Koala
I used to
Blue,
see the one on Melrose.
Yeah, that was the first one. That was our flagship. our baby. Pat and my baby.
When you say ours or yours, who else was involved?
Pat Carroll, who is now Pat Farish. She and I started it as... just a thing we just wanted to do. I was away on tour, and I called Pat up because we're very close, and I said, you know, when I was away, I really missed, you know, meat pies. I ate a lot of meat and milkshakes in those days. I don't now, but I missed milkshakes and meat pies, and wouldn't it be great to open a milk bar in Los Angeles? That was my dream. We get the Australian magazines, we get, you know, all the you know, Violet Crumbles and Cherry Ripes and all those things I loved, and Jaffles and Minties, and make salad sandwiches because you couldn't get a good sandwich there. Why don't we open a milk bar? So she called me the next morning and said she hadn't slept all night, and why didn't we open an all-Australian store with clothes from Australia and art and all these different things? So We got together and brainstormed, and within a week we had briefcases and we came to Sydney. And we went around to all the shops in the harbour, and actually the first stop we made was Ken Doan's shop, because his look was exactly what we wanted. We wanted something very vivid with colour, and just struck as we went by and we went, oh, look at that, that's exactly how we see the logo. And we asked Ken if he would do a sign for us, and that's how it started.
How did it end?
It didn't end well, unfortunately. We ended up going into Chapter 11 because we got into some financial problems. I don't want to go into the depths of it because it was all to do with business and business partnerships that kind of went awry. But it was really unfortunate because I think we had really nice clothes.
Do you think you got used a bit?
I think that in the end, people came after me because, you know, they see the name and they see celebrity, and so I got attacked financially and we got sued and we went to court, and this is all I'm going through chemotherapy, so that was another awful compounder of the whole thing. You know, I was really not well and having to go through depositions, and that was a really terrible time.
And did you lose a lot of money?
A lot of money, yeah. Pat and I both, because we did the thing that you're not supposed to do, use your own money. That's like the first rule of business. But we wanted to do it ourselves, and so we did that. But the wonderful thing about it is that Pat and John and my friendship wasn't impacted at all. I mean, I remember we hired a very powerful lawyer in Los Angeles to represent us because we were being sued by a lot of the
suppliers,
licensees, because they saw me, basically. And he called us into a room one day and he said, you know, maybe you girls should get separate representation, because I've seen what happens when these big lawsuits happen and the friends ended up hating each other and suing each other. And we looked at each other and said, are you kidding? We're in this together, and whatever happens, we split it down the middle. And that's exactly what happened, and it never impacted our friendship. We have total trust.
Was it just the wrong time? Would it work today if you did it again? Not that you want to.
Yeah, I think it was not to do with timing. I think the timing was good even then. I think it was just unfortunate business mistakes that went on that we weren't aware of, actually.
When you came here and did the 98 tour with Cliff Richard, how long had it been since you'd done a live show?
Like 12 or 13 years, I think.
Really?
Yeah, I have to credit Cliff for that, Sir Cliff, because he called me and asked me would I be a guest on his show out here, and I was really, really nervous. But because it was him, I thought, well, it's a good way to test the waters and see if I can do it. So I feel safe with him because I started out really with Cliff on his television show in the 70s, so it was wonderful. We sing well together, and suddenly we had a couple of hit records together. So I felt really safe, and I only had to do about 5 songs and then a couple with him. And that really got me back singing live again. Then when I was asked to do the main event, and that was with John Farnham and Anthony Warlow, both of who I love, their voices, I thought, well, here's another opportunity to test the waters, and I had a wonderful time. And after that, I did a tour on my own in America.
Let's have a look at Olivia performing live. An album, I think, around the same time, an album with some country music on it.
In America then? Yeah. Yes, I had an album out called Back With A Heart that I recorded in Nashville. I went down there and wrote all the songs down there and recorded with Nashville musicians. It was really fun.
Back in those early days when you had Soul 4,
yeah.
Did you think of country music then? Did you ever consider that you'd sing country music? Because you kind of got a country music label.
Yeah, it's interesting. Peter Gormley, who was my manager, who was Cliff Richard's manager for many years, loved country music. Now, I didn't really know that style of music was separate from any other kind, because in England they play country and pop and R&B and everything on the radio. So he kind of steered me in that direction, and Bruce Welsh, who was producing me, also found some songs that John Rostel had written. John Rostel was in the Shadows in those days. So I kind of found myself recording that style, which is kind of folky, which kind of suited my style of voice in those days. And I got to like it, you know, even though I caused a bit of a stir in Nashville at the time, because I was this Australian girl living in England, recording a song by an Englishman, recorded by an Aussie and Englishman, and winning these awards in Nashville, they weren't too thrilled with me for a while.
Did you like Nashville?
I do very much.
The feel of it?
I do very much. The people are great, and yes. It's a very pretty place, too.
We'll have a little break here, and I'll come back and talk some more with Olivia Newton-John. Don't go away. I'm glad you're still there, as my very special guest is Olivia Newton-John. What's your main aim now?
My main aim? Goodness. To be healthy and happy and enjoy my life, which I'm really, really doing.
Well, you sure look healthy and you sure seem happy.
I am.
That's good. And you're enjoying life.
Very much. Yes.
Would you ever come back to Australia to live?
Well, I have a place here, so I come back as often as I can. And I see myself doing that more as time goes on. And Chloe loves to come back, but her life and, well, her schooling is there at the moment, and her father's living there at the moment, so it's hard to be here full time. But back and forth, and I think I'll be here. As I'm an old lady, I like to see myself in the garden out here, you know.
They'll have to change the quarantine laws, though, won't they?
So I know, my dogs. That's actually my big... I forgot. Yeah, that's been a big problem, bringing the animals out. I wouldn't do that to them. I actually went to the quarantine place a few years ago when I was really thinking about it. I went to the quarantine place and I couldn't do it to them. So we'll have to wait and see. When it's a real short trip, then I can do it.
You talk about this old lady that I don't think any of us can quite envisage, but being in a garden, do you like gardens?
I love gardens now. I'm in a new house in America and it has about 200 rose plants, and I love roses, always have, but never really had them. But I'm so in love with these roses. Every morning I go out there, and we've just gone through our summer, and there's like 50 different varieties and different colors, and my whole garden smells of roses and jasmine, and it's beautiful. And I'm trying to learn a bit about gardening, and it's very, can't believe it, I sound like an old lady already. I'm learning about gardening and pruning, and it's very relaxing. And I can understand why people like it so much. It's a wonderful thing.
For the ladies in our audience, what's an average sort of day?
Average sort of day? Goodness.
When
I'm working or not? I don't
not
have
work,
an average
not
kind
working.
Of day. I don't know what an average day is, because my life is always different every day, which I shouldn't complain about, because it is always different and interesting. But if it was an average day when I wasn't actually working and my daughter was at home, I would be getting up in the morning early, letting the dogs out, feeding the cats, feeding the dog, taking the cover off the birds, feeding the birds.
Cats, did you say, plural?
I have three cats. I have three dogs. I have a couple of birds. I would make breakfast for my daughter and take it up to her, because I've learnt that blood sugar levels in the morning, she gets up better that way. So that's our little time together. I take a breakfast in bed and we have our little chat, and I take her to school. This would be my perfect day, okay? Then I would take her to school, come home, go to a yoga class, come back, take the dog for a walk on the beach, have lunch, maybe with a friend, maybe with Pat and John Farrer. Maybe play tennis. This would be my perfect day. Pick up my daughter from school. What would I do after that? Goodness, all this time with no work, I can't imagine it. Play in the garden a little bit. Take the dog for another walk, and then it would be dinner time and hang out with Chloe time and have her. She usually has a... I have a house full of teenagers now. We're at the time where I usually have about 5 to 7 young girls in my house, and they often stay the weekend. So I'm really enjoying that. It's really fun.
Sounds like a pretty good sort of life.
Yeah, it's a wonderful life. That's a day when I'm not busy, but it hasn't been like that for a long time. I'm usually on the phone doing something, doing emails, which I've just learned. I love email. Do you have email?
Sure.
I'm so excited. I was probably the last person on the planet to find it. I've only known about it or known how to do it for about 3 months. It's fantastic. I love it.
Do you shop on the net?
No.
Because you can find...
I like going and looking at it. I don't have...
Where do you go to that wretched Rodeo Drive where all the money
often.
Gets spent?
No, not very often. I usually shop locally. Like where I live, we have really... It's wonderful. Where I live now, I can walk, which I've never had that luxury before, but it's a really wonderful area where I can basically walk anywhere. It's really good.
What frightens you?
Oh, goodness. Not that much, really. I mean, if... Sharks, poisonous snakes. I mean, in life, I don't know. I try not to live in fear, and I try to live in the moment, and I try not to dwell on things that are frightening and try to keep a positive thought, because I think it's really important for peace of mind and for good health.
I was reading the other day where somebody was saying, I think a psychologist or psychiatrist in London was saying that it's not a good idea to be too positive because the world's never that good. It's better to have positive negativity.
I understand that. Realism. Yeah, realism is important.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not like everything's airy-fairy and everything's incredible, but you asked me what frightens me, as I try not to think about it too much. I couldn't answer you. I also believe this, that if you talk about those things, you draw them to you. I think if you talk about what you're afraid of, you attract it to you. So I try not to even entertain the thoughts.
Well, I hope you never have to be frightened of
anything.
Thank
you. You too.
And it was wonderful talking to you.
Thank you, you too. I've enjoyed it.
I've enjoyed it so much. And I'm sure you'll do wonderful things.
Thank you.
One being come back and live in Australia one day. We'd love to see you.
Thank you, John.
Olivia's latest CD called One Woman Live Journey has just been released in Australia, so you can find it in your local music store, and I do commend it to you. It's wonderful. That's all we have in the show for tonight. Until we see you tomorrow night, and I hope we do. Goodbye.